I now call this regular meeting of the Board of Education to order at 7 o'clock on the dot. How about that? We'll take a moment of silence followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Remind the board members that when you're called upon to have your microphone on so that our TV viewing audience and the audience in the room can hear you, I will ask the coordinator to call the roll.
Ms. Jackson?
Present.
Mr. Rollins? Mr. Scrivano?
Here.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Here.
Dr. Herner?
Here.
Mr. Connor?
Here.
Mrs. Powers?
Here.
With 7 present, we have a quorum.
Thank you. I'd like to recognize our audiovisual students from Auburn High School, Stephen Halen and Ronald Cash, who are helping with the video production tonight. Thank you for being here. We will now recognize and celebrate outstanding contributions of our students and our staff. And Mr. Earl Dotson Jr., you have the floor, sir.
Thank you, sir, and good evening to everyone. Channel 13, WREX, in partnership with Rockford University, recently recognized 2 RPS middle school teachers with their Teacher of the Week award. Karen Portis.
Yes, let's go ahead and applaud right now. Yes,
absolutely. A long time Rockford Public Schools language arts teacher has dedicated her career to helping RPS students. She was surprised in her classroom at West Middle School in January. The story focused on the way she encourages self-expression and creativity in class, and even raps literature with her students. She told WREX, "I'm here to make a difference in the lives of my students, and that's the reason that I come every day." Dan Sirian, a health teacher at Lincoln Middle School, was highlighted earlier this month for the advice he gives his students. "Make good decisions that will set you up for the future," he told WREX. "If they can decide today that they're going to make good choices today, then when the peer pressure is on and the refusal skills that I teach them are needed, then they will know how to respond." He uses his background in psychology to talk with students about how they can make the best choices. And it's in those conversations that keep him excited about teaching. Thank you, Mr. Sirian and Mrs. Portis, for all you do for Rockford Public Schools and its students. I'd also like to acknowledge her principal, Macy O'Raney. Macy O'Raney is in the audience.
Gotta be a hug.
I would also like to acknowledge Representative Chuck Jefferson, who is here to support Karen.
Do you know why my microphone is flashing?
Back. The Guilford High School boys bowling team earned the Nick 10 Conference Championship before winning the IHSA Regional Tournament in Dixon. The team then beat out 23 teams at the state tournament to bring home Guilford's second state boys bowling championship in a 4-year span. It's been a great season for the team. Individual honors include all five varsity starting players being named to the all-conference team. Alex Summer, Sam Doble, Dalton Kafka, Brett Specker, and Trustin Givens. Additional accolades go to Alex Summer, who led the Nick 10 with a 234 average, and Brett Specker, who earned All-State honors at the IHSA State Tournament for placing in the top 12 individually. Teammates include Chris Arco, Sam Doble, James Ekstrom, Trustin Givens, Dalton Kafka, Thomas Rotello, Alex Summer, and Brett Sprecher. The team is coached by Brad Summer and Mac Evans. Volunteer coaches are Don Wessel, Mike Winquist, and Kevin Webster. Let's give a warm round of applause and congratulations on your achievements to the Guilford High School Vikings. Woo! And just a quick few words from the coach. Coach, I'm going to say something really quick.
Dr. Jarrett, thank you. Thank you, board members and everybody in attendance. That medal hanging around your neck is sure to add 30 pins to your average.
All right. I need the help.
Great job, team.
Thank you.
Last thing, I just want to recognize their principal, Janice Hawkins, is also here to support her team. Janice. Thank you, sir. That is all. Thank you.
Thank you. I just told Dr. Jarrett that my highest average in bowling in high school was 159, and somebody had a 232 average or something, so holy cow.
Holy cow.
That's pretty good. Thank you all for being here. We are now at the petitions and communication portion of our meeting when we invite the public to make comments. The First Amendment of the United States Constitution guarantees the rights of citizens to petition their government as well as provides for freedom of speech. Also, the Illinois School Code requires that there be time at regular and special meetings for public comment. Thus, we are following those mandates during this petitions and communication portion of our agenda. According to the Board Policy 2.230, the public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. The Board will not respond to comments at this time. If it is appropriate, you will be contacted in a timely manner by staff in response to your questions. We only have two tonight, so I don't need to go through the whole instructions, but I'll just ask you to watch the two-minute time, and the clock is on the wall to help you with your timing. So our first speaker tonight is Colleen McGee. I think you need to turn it on.
Right there. Okay, thank you.
There we go.
Okay, I wanted to talk for just a little bit about the code of conduct meetings that are being held right now. And I was at a parent group meeting the other night, and several parents expressed interest in wanting to attend those meetings. And there was one parent there who had attended the first meeting, and she said that she was the only parent in attendance at that meeting. Now, if you don't want parents to participate, you're doing a good job, just keep it up. But if you want parents to participate in these meetings, you need to get the word out to the parents. The parents that were there that wanted to attend said they had no idea what the meeting, where the meetings were, when the meetings were, any of that kind of stuff. And I was thinking about it after the meeting, and I thought, you know, I was watching the evening news, and they were talking about Transform Rockford meetings. And my guess is everybody in this room has heard about Transform Rockford and where and when their meetings are. Seems like they have meetings 3, 4, 5 times a week. They have them in the housing projects. They have them in the rural areas. They have them in inner city. Morning, evening, afternoon, weekends, everything. I think if we want parents to attend these meetings about the code of conduct, we need to maybe follow suit with Transform Rockford and start having meetings in places that are convenient for parents to get to and at times that are convenient for parents. You know, I think we assume that everyone has a car, but they don't. We assume that everyone has someone at home to take care of their kids so they can go to a meeting. That's not always an option. We assume that everybody works from 8 to 4, and that's not the case. So I would strongly encourage you to look at the timing of the meetings and the locations of the meetings. Also, you know, I looked on the district's website to see when the meetings were. They're not on the activity calendar. They're not on the meetings calendar. Now, I'm no computer whiz, but I went through and could not find any of them. So you really need to get the word out on those meetings. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Comey. And our second speaker is Laura Ramey, or Rami, Ramey. Or just Laura, right?
Just Laura.
Okay, all right.
Thank you. It's been brought to my attention that a decision on Tuesday was made to restrict the Running Start program offered by the Rockford Public School District students. The program offered by our community college, Rock Valley, the Running Start program offers qualifying students the opportunity to partake in college credit courses while finishing their high school degree. A program also offered by other districts. A letter was dated February 6th, sent out to the students that took the placement test at Rock Valley College. It states that students are selected as an alternate for the Rock Valley College Engineering Program. The letter continues to read that the Rockford Public School District will only offer limited seating for students interested in the engineering program. Back in November, it was understood that students receiving a certificate could apply for the Running Start program offered at Rock Valley College. 3 months later, it's learned that the district is not going to offer the Running Start program to those not interested in engineering. The decision to only allow select students to participate in an 84-credit program over the next 2 years is unacceptable. What about those students that did qualify and want to study nursing, business, or even teaching? Why would a decision to only allow students interested in engineering participate in this college and career readiness program? I'm asking for an explanation on why students of this district are now unable to participate in the Running Start program, and I hope to encourage you, the school board meeting, the school board, to look into the Running Start program and to open it back up, allowing our students to participate in this great and wonderful program.
Thank you, Laura. We are now at the board member comment section. Are there any board member comments? Mrs. Powers.
So I had to take off my pink scarf because it clashed with my Celebrate Black History Month pin that we all got from Mr. Abramson and Mr. LaRosa from Auburn High School, along with these very cool bands that have something about Black history on both sides of it. I've also displayed Rock Valley College has got a fantastic schedule of Black History Month events. So if you're interested, go out to their site, and they have got a really great calendar with events all over the city as well as at their own location. And then secondly, I just wanted to say congratulations to Mr. Lewis and his team, Mr. Keffer, for the award for Outstanding Financial Excellence, and way to go. Thank you.
Mrs. McCullough.
I just wanted to bring my fellow board members as well as the community up to date on the Facilities Task Force Steering Committee. That's the committee that was put in place after we hired DLR, the architects, to help us pretty much determine whether or not the decisions that the board had made about how to spend the bond money were justified by a lot of objective data. Is that me? Maybe too many on. I wanted to let you know that we are meeting, we added an extra meeting for the month of February. We're meeting tomorrow morning at 8:30. And what we're going to finally really start diving into is all the objective criteria about the schools, the data charts about their mechanics, their air quality, all those pieces. We're going to be looking at some of the CoLab summaries. That means the groups that have been meeting around the community, both educational groups, community groups, and are giving us their input on their vision. Mr. Schmidt is going to be reviewing some of the building projects that we've already undertaken so that we can impart that information into the data system that we're using. We're going to talk a little bit about where we have our programs, where our students are, and what our vision is for the educational delivery in the district. So just to keep you up to date, and I want to remind the board members who were given a paper tonight to make sure that before you leave, to fill that sheet out. Just what we're trying to do is make sure that we all are on the same page as to what the goal is for the steering committee, the outcome. What is it we all want to see at the end? That probably is something everybody thinks should have been at the front end, but I think as you start looking at all the information and start coming up with some projections and where and what and how, really leads you to ask the question more seriously and more defined about what is the outcome. So thank you.
Mr. Connor.
I'd like to give congratulations to the Jefferson High School art program. There's a regional art exhibition for 2014 that comes from 68 different high schools in the Chicagoland area. And there's a number of Jefferson artists, Doreen Manning, Demetrius Markham, Lena Morris, Deanna Pacheco, and Dylan Witt. Congratulations to all them for being part of the exhibitions. There's apparently $250,000 in merit scholarships that are part of this, so congratulations to the Jefferson Art Program.
Any other, Ms. Jackson?
I do. I had an opportunity to attend the meeting that our speaker spoke about, and so some concerns were expressed, and I'm going to email together and send it to board members with some of the things that came up at that meeting.
Mr. Rollins.
Just wanted to say I was at the open house at McIntosh last night, which I think is the last of the six open houses for the six elementary schools that we did the additions for. I didn't get to all of the open houses, but I got to some of them, and everyone that I got to, you could see the kids were excited about what we've done. The staff were excited. There's just really high energy in all of those buildings, and I just want to say that I'm looking forward to even more open houses as we continue to work on these facilities.
Okay, thank you. Any other board member comments? All right, we will now move on to the consent portion of our agenda, including the following consent items: meeting minutes of January 28th and January 18th of this year, payroll, accounts payable, purchase orders, contracts under $10,000, air travel, and the following three bid recommendations: RFQ 14-18, which is the architectural services for remodeling at Jefferson High School, RFQ 14-20, the architectural service for auditorium remodeling projects, and RFP 14-28, second insurance network administrator. Also recurring contracts, the Leadership Academy with Northern Illinois University, and the appointment of a fifth member to the committee for a sabbatical leave, and the Freedom of Information Act log. Is there a motion and a second to approve these consent items?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor. Seconded by Mr. Rollins. Are there any consent items that board members wish to have pulled for separate consideration? Mrs. McCulloch.
7D, purchase orders.
7D, okay. Any others? Ms. Powers.
10A.
10A, okay. Ms. Jackson.
10B.
10B.
Okay. 8.
Eight, all of them, okay. So we'll have the coordinator call the roll and the approval of the consent items not pulled.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scirrano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. I'll now take a motion and a second to approve purchase orders, item 7D.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
By Dr. Harner. Questions or discussion on 7D payroll, purchase orders? Mrs. McCulloch?
I'm sorry to, if I'm taking the board's time, but I had sent an email asking for a rundown. We have some purchase orders for Hagney Architects that are for additional services. They're extending a bunch of POs for additional services. And so I just wanted to understand where we were. I wasn't sure if this was part of our contingency, additional architect. And so I had asked Mr. Schmidt, and so he's told me he's ready to go with the answers.
Yes, on those, the POs were for the additional services for the additions, and then the board approved for the windows and the mechanicals. For a couple of these things you see on there for the geotechnical, that's some of the reimbursable pass-through costs for civil engineering, geotechnical engineering, testing, soil borings, and any other reimbursables that we have for the individual project. Rerouting some of the sanitary routes in there, getting some of the special permits in there for that $350. So these are all things that we have in there that we're doing part of the project that's a pass-through or reimbursable for Hagney Architecture.
Right, but my specific question to you, and that's what I had written, was when it says additional services, are those, is that contingency money, or is that, when they say additional services, is that part of it was originally anticipated in the contract? So, for example, I mean, there's three or four of them.
Well, the one for the additional services for the $350 was sanitary routes, which we did have money allocated for that. For the additional services up there for $28,800, that's for the civil engineering, for the parking lot that we put out there, for the paving, for the detention, the sanitary storm sewer. So those are fees that we did have allocated in there as the full architects and engineering fees for the project.
So the $57,000 for an additional architect, was that part of the original expectation?
If you go down there on that one, there's the design fees. Yeah, I remember that the board initially approved December 18th, 2012, and that was for the additions. Then we brought back a proposal that we would also have Hagney Architectural Firm provide the additional architects and engineering designs for the mechanical systems, for the windows, and some other work out there. So that's what that PO is for. So one is for the addition, and then the other one is for the rest of the work out the building, because what we looked at is it would be better to have one architectural firm do all the architects and engineering. So that's what that second big PO is for. That's why you see that on both of them. For the top one is Froberg, and or for 60-38, that's Froberg, and then 60-61 is McIntosh.
And then the other question I asked, do all these, Mr. Rollins, do all these come through ops committee as you guys are adding additional services, additional architects? Because if they're all being vetted there, then that could
specific
save the
POs
question.
Don't. You know, the additional services, I mean, that's all been gone through ops committee and or the board.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll now take a motion for approving the bid recommendations 8A, B, and C.
So moved.
Oh, I suppose we should probably do that. Let's have a vote on the approval of the purchase orders first. So I'll have the coordinator call the roll. My fault.
Mr. Rollins? Mr. Scirrano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
Okay, now I'll take a motion to approve items 8A, B, and C, which are the bid recommendations. Mr. Connor?
So moved.
Okay. Second by Dr. Harner. Questions or discussion? Ms. Jackson, I think this, was this yours? Okay. Seeing no questions, we'll have the coordinator call the roll on the approval of the motion to approve items 8A, B, and C, the three bid recommendations.
Mr. Scirbano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch? Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson? Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
The motion passes with six yeses and one no.
Okay, I'll now take a motion to approve items 10A, the appointment of a fifth member to the committee for sabbatical leave.
So moved.
Mr. Connor moves.
Second.
By Dr. Harner. Questions or discussion on item 10A? Mrs. Powers.
So can we get a little background of where this is coming from? It's my understanding that this language has been part of the teacher's contract forever, and so I'm wondering why it is, after all these years, we're asking for a fifth member to be assigned and what the background to that is.
Yes, whenever the language states that a committee will be formed whenever an REA member requests for sabbatical leave, and in the past, it's always been approved or denied. In this case, we have a tie. So we need a fifth, and administration is recommending the deputy superintendent to be the fifth voting.
So this committee has already met, and because I'm paraphrasing, but what we ask our students to do, which is to have conflict resolution, we can't come to any conflict resolution, so we have to change a policy to have somebody else step in?
Well, this isn't a change to the policy. This is how it's always been written. We've just never encountered a tie in this last several years. It's 2-2.
But the way I understand it is that we're asking for there to be a fifth voting member, which is new and different.
The language hasn't changed, to my understanding. This is just the first time it's come across as a tie.
What is the current committee structure? Who are the
two
voting
REA,
members?
Two REA members and two administrators.
Right, so we're making a change to have a fifth voting member.
Because it's a tie, 2-2.
I think I read it that the fifth voting member would only vote in the event of a tie.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Correct.
The protocol.
So we're currently at an impasse.
Yes. Or a tie. I don't know if
it's but it's written to. But it's written such a way where when you get to 2-2, then this is the next step written into the policy. This is not something we are amending.
Right.
So then what is it you're specifically asking for? For Mr. Vosburgh to be that person? I mean, I interpreted it as you're looking for us to have a fifth person. And secondly, you're recommending Mr. Vosburgh. Are you just saying now that this fifth person thing has always existed? So what we are voting on is that person is Mr. Vosburgh?
Correct. That's correct.
That is not the way I read it at all.
Any other comments or questions?
I do have one. Is
Ms.
it
Jackson?
Just for this purpose, or will he be the fifth member from here on out?
Specific to this purpose only.
Specific to this purpose only.
In the event, it's broader than that, the way it's written. He would be the fifth person until the board assigns somebody else. So in the event you encounter this situation again.
Or someone else, we could assign someone else to
correct.
That position. So it's two REA and two administrators. Is that what I heard you say, Mr. Contreras? How do you decide between whether it'll be another REA individual or another administrator?
It's, again, the board's decision. This is our recommendation that it be the deputy superintendent.
I understand that, but how do you make that distinction between REA? Did they have a say in saying we want someone from the REA, or does that work?
It's up to the board.
The way the contract language reads is that the board would assign. So
we're not. We're voting on the recommendation from the administration. That's what we're doing.
Which
we're not
would
assigning.
Be assigning, and should you choose to replace that recommendation, you could.
Any other questions or comments? Now I'll have the coordinator call the roll on the motion to approve the appointment of the Mr. Vosburgh to be the fifth member of the sabbatical leave committee.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
No.
Ms. Jackson?
No.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scribano?
Yes.
The motion passes with 5 yeses and 2 noes.
I'll now take a motion to approve the Freedom of Information Act log.
So moved.
By Mr. Connor. Second?
Second
by Ms. McCulloch. Any questions or discussion on the Freedom of Information Act log? Ms. Jackson.
I'd just like to be copied on the response to the NAACP.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Now I'll have the coordinator call the roll on the approval of the Freedom of Information Act log.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scribano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
Okay, thank you. We are now at closed session consent items, 11A and B, legal counsel compensation, and HR organizational report and addendum. In addition to that, we have the closed session consent items of student discipline, in which listed students are prohibited from being on school grounds and school-sponsored activities without the prior written permission of the principal, and suspensions are affirmed. The following students are expelled for the remainder of this school year and the first semester of next school year, CAR 18 and SD 32. The expulsions for the following students are held in abeyance contingent upon a conditional probationary agreement, JJK 21, VR 22, JLB 28, and ASM 30. And the following students have been granted a conditional probationary agreement. TEJ 2, DTC 4, ADCG 8, boy, say that twice, ZBW 10, BMK 11, WB 16, and AGM 17. Is there a motion and a second to approve the closed session consent items?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Mr. Rollins. Are there any items that board members would like to have pulled for separate consideration? Mrs. Powers.
General counsel compensation.
Okay. That is 11A. Any other items that board members would like pulled? Okay. Now I have the coordinator call the roll on the items not pulled under the consent items.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scribano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
Thank you. I'll now take a motion to approve item 11A, which is legal counsel compensation.
So moved.
Mr. Connor moves.
Second.
Second by Mr. Rollins. There is no discussion, so I'll have the coordinator call the roll on the approval of closed session consent item 11A, legal counsel compensation.
Mrs. Powers?
No.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scribano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses and 1 no.
Thank you. Next on our agenda is the superintendent's report. I'll turn that over to Dr. Jarrett.
We have a special report this evening from Alignment Rockford to provide the board some time, so I want to cede my time to that group to provide their report and talk about some of the good things that are happening in the community. So with that, I'll turn it over to the combination of school leadership team and community volunteers.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to provide an update. Today, this is a semi-annual update that we plan to give and follow the reporting schedule that has been established. Each of our committees is going to provide an update to you Todd, are you going to, yeah. Yeah, there is a PowerPoint presentation that goes with it. Thanks, perfect, perfect. So while Rockford Public Schools is utilizing its internal resources, your buildings, your teachers, your budget, Alignment Rockford committees are busy designing and delivering tactics that support your strategies for student success. And they do that by engaging resources that are external to the district. Typically, these are what we refer to as non-traditional resources, meaning they're not a dollar budget. They might include organizations that are in our community, people's time and their expertise, the networks that they have developed, events that are taking place, technology, transportation, media, all of those are things that we seek to utilize to serve the public school's strategic plan. Each committee is briefly going to outline their activities in the context of the Alignment Working Committee process, the process that our organization follows to deliver solutions for you. And each of these committees has activities that are in different phases of this process, and so that's what you're going, that's what you've seen in your board book, that sort of cycle of work. The College Readiness Committee, which is forming right now at the district's request, has their first meeting this next Thursday, and at the end of this presentation, we'll show you preliminary membership on that committee.
Okay, good evening. The Healthy Starts Committee has designed a tactic to get the word out on our preschool program. So we're trying to increase parent and community awareness of our program. This invitation to participate seeks organizations that would be willing to host our enrollment information on site. We're also seeking organizations that would be willing to host an actual child find event on site. And during a child find event, we actually take RPS to the community. Our early childhood staff is available to do the comprehensive screenings at their locations. We have our enrollment information there. We bring our computers. We can actually enroll, play, screen the child on site. That way, we're eliminating the barrier of transportation and having parents have to find us. So this invitation to participate is going to our operation board on Thursday, and we're hoping to get it out soon.
Really, the purpose of this invitation to participate is to help the early childhood program with the enrollment for the 2014-2015 school year. And we're anticipating about 1,300 four-year-olds will be moving up into kindergarten and will need to be replaced. And what we've been doing as a committee is attempting to find where the biggest need is in our community. Are there any underserved communities that are, for some reason, aren't getting kids into the preschool program? And what we've done is identified areas with limited access in the community. And those main zip codes were the 61101, 0204, and 09 areas. And those are the ones that we want to concentrate on the most.
And we know, and you know too, that research has shown that high-quality preschool programs help our children enter kindergarten ready to learn. So our committee is just committed to supporting the district's Readiness Rock of moving preschool for all forward. And enrollment is our first step.
Thank you.
Won't dwell on it tonight, but recognize that top bullet up there under ownership, under the Pathways Committee, that's recognizing the work we're doing for the high school redesigns that are underway. I spoke to the Guilford and Auburn Academy coaches today. They're enrolling students, the freshmen today, at this time, in their academies for next year. Over 400 kids at Auburn have enrolled, seeing a nice balance across the four academies. They'll complete that process in the next month or 6 weeks or so, and next year we'll have all of our high school students enrolled in college and career academies, and that's really remarkable. It's in kind of a sustainment mode now, right? We have academy support teams assigned to all of the high schools for each of the individual career academies that are there. We're working, I was asked not to solicit too strongly to get new participants into those today while we get the schools up and running first, and then we'll bring on the academy support teams. The mood in Jefferson, the feedback I've had is it's really, really favorable. So we're really excited about it. We have a second ITP we'll be sending out here in a month or so to do a second round of the teacher site visits. We did it last year for the teachers, aiming principally at Jefferson's teachers. This year we'll expand it to all of the high school teachers across the community, across the RPS 205. We're going to do two sessions, one the last day of July and one in the first week of August. First one will catch just teachers who haven't been through one of these yet, and then the second one will catch the Jefferson teachers who've been through one and have some more specific demands or desires for their relationships between the teaching and the business and civic community that's out there. And so that ITP will be coming out to drive those events that occur yet this summer. The third one there is down in the community engagement process is a new one, and Chip Hickman is kind of helped driving this one with us. He's my committee lead, and he was supposed to be here tonight, but is out sick, I think. So I'll try to give it justice. So we're gonna pilot this spring the introduction of SLCs and PLCs, small learning community development time, teacher development time, and Dr. Jerry, you have to fix me again on PLCs. Professional learning communities, there you go. Professional learning communities. So it'll be a time once a week for 5 weeks where the teachers will actually use class time, use the morning session to get together as teachers and work on either activities across their curriculums or activities inside of their, and to provide that to students to not have that be a loss of time, we're opening that up to be a time for the community members to reach in. So we've solicited through the invitation to participate process volunteer organizations to see what they could come bring to the classroom environment, bring to the school environment during that 1 hour a week in that 5 week period, late April, early May. We've had over 21 participants. We expect to get 30 different companies, 30 different organizations, they range anywhere from people coming in to help them talk about how to write a resume, how to fill out a job application, to banks to come in and talk about financing. We're getting good response on that one. The scheme is we'll practice that this year pilot it this year at Guilford and at Jefferson, and then next year, with the success based on that, we'll introduce that across all four high schools in the next year. So that's what we're doing for the Pathways Committee.
Good evening. This year, the Career Awareness Committee is going to be putting on the Academy Expo 2014. I'd like to announce that we have selected a date as Tuesday, September 16th. Write that down. We're going to want you to know that. We would have liked to have had that a little bit later in the year, but that's the latest date we could get before the ice goes in at the BMO Center. And though I am intrigued by having an Academy Expo on ice, it's not going to happen this year. Okay. But we're really looking forward to it. As you know, what the Academy Expo is designed to do is to introduce our ninth grade students to careers so that it will help them make an informed decision when they select their academies in January 2015. So we've had great participation in the past from the community. It also introduces the teachers to the community organizations that want to help them succeed, show their support, and it really is an exciting event that brings the whole community together around what we think is a premier event for newcomers into their high school career. Survey results from the last year have shown that it was too crowded, it was too noisy, and there wasn't enough time. So fortunately, by going back down to just ninth graders this year, we're going to be able to address those concerns. We're going to be able to have a really high quality event. We're going to have two sessions that are going to be longer rather than three sessions that are really compact. And as far as noisy, I don't know if we're going to try and do sign language or what, but we'll figure that one out too. So.
In conjunction with our efforts to continue scaling the Academy Expo, we're also working then to create opportunities and structures for other work-based learning opportunities for our students. And so we're in the midst of designing a solution around how do we ensure there's clear communication between community members and school staff regarding expectations and scheduling and feedback after a presentation or a site visit or an internship experience transpires. And so as a part of that, last year, Lyman Rockford dissolved its elementary education committee, and we've inherited some of those members, and they helped to support a career day at Lewis Lemon. And so we're also, at the same time, exploring the possibility of continuing that support for elementary career day. So we met with the principals from a few of our elementary schools, McIntosh, Lewis Lemon, and Walker, and we're going to have another discussion on the 18th to continue looking at, is there a solution that we could potentially design using Alignment Rockford processes to support a career day experience in all of our elementary schools. So that's something that's in the works, and we're having great discussions around that. I'll stay at the podium here for the next committee, which is our newest committee. We have a loose mission, vision that we shared with committee members as potential committee members. So we put together that our goal is to nurture a culture that inspires all students to pursue continuing education and training beyond high school graduation. So we're not committed to that, but that was the mission that we've used as a focal point as we had lunch with potential members a few weeks ago to make sure that they're aware of how Alignment Rockford works, what the processes are, and where we see the potential future of this committee heading. And so, as Lori indicated, we'll be having our first meeting next week. On the next slide here is a list of those potential committee members who came, had that lunchtime experience with us, had some conversation about the processes as well as potential projects that we may decide to dig into. And in addition to these folks, these are all external to the school district. Tiffany Wedley will be serving alongside myself, and we've invited numerous high school and middle school counselors to be a part of this committee as well. So that representation up there is from the community as far as who's going to be taking part in that committee. So at this time, if there's any questions, or Dr. Jarrett, any instruction, further comments you'd like?
Well, just I would like to thank the group. One of the things, the process, we did transition out a committee and add in a different one. And I think one of the things I want to highlight, when you look at the superintendent's goals and you look at board priorities and the strategic plan that the district has set forth, that the board has asked us to focus on those priorities and those goals, I think the work that this community group, Alignment Rockford, is doing is really providing a lot of great support. So I want to thank all of you for your efforts and for working so well with our staff. It's greatly appreciated, and I think we're starting to see some really great results, so thank you.
I would just like to say thank you to Bob, Glenn, Earl, Kim, David, and Lori. Thank you for being here, and I would like to set out a challenge to Mr. Dotson Jr. that President Obama recently was at Nashville to visit Nashville Alignment. So I'm thinking maybe you could extend an invitation to President Obama on September 16th. See if he might want to come to Rockford and go to the Career Academy Expo. What do you think? Wouldn't that be a great idea? Okay. So thank you all, and thank you for your committee members. Dr. Hearn.
So, just a quick question. With respect to the preschool kids, are you considering how to facilitate the physical exams for these kids and families?
You know, 2 years ago, we did some community outreach in a couple of different areas, taking our screening office on the road, so to speak, and we did hook up with the Ronald McDonald Mobile to have that available on site as well. We didn't have very many parents participate in that, but that is certainly something we can look at doing again because, you know, our thought was one-stop shop. Get your kids screened, fill out your enrollment paperwork, get your physical, get your shots, and you're good to go. Because we know, especially in some of these areas that are under-enrolled right now, part of the issue is access and transportation and getting all that done. So that is certainly something we can work on. And I believe the Rockford Memorial Hospital's parking lot has that in their parking lot right now, right? Ronald McDonald. I've got an in.
It goes in and out.
I think I have an in.
I can
in.
Work on that.
But we did try that 2 years ago, and because we didn't get a huge number of people going through there last year when we wanted to use them again, they were kind of like, well, no, we didn't get a large response. But again, that is an advertising and making the public aware that it's there. This invitation to participate will be going out to the Alignment database. We're hoping to be extremely busy, and if we can really get some of the faith-based organizations and different organizations in these high-need zip codes, we really think we can make an impact. Some of our data shows that we're under-enrolled in those areas, and that's where we need to be enrolled the highest. So that's where we're focusing.
Can I comment on that?
Sure, you may comment, Ms.
Because the school-based health center is going to be opening up at Auburn this fall, actually this August, and that will target dentist students, so that's one group of all those students in that area could be referred to those services.
Yes, and I know I was at Dennis when, right before parent conferences, and Mr. Richardson didn't pass out the information to his teachers to give to the parents on parent conferences.
Ms. Powers, you're next.
So on the early childhood piece, some might say I was stalking this little girl next to me at the basketball game Saturday, but she was adorable. And when I was talking to the mom about where does she go to school, well, I'm having a hard time, blah, blah, blah. Do we have a 1-2-3 that I can hand?
Absolutely.
So if you could make sure that gets in my next board packet so that I can have it on my person, that'd be great.
We absolutely can do that for you. And we're working on some other things to make that easier for parents,
good,
too, so they can access on the website. We're about that close.
And she doesn't have access.
Okay.
So a hand, a piece of paper would be great. And 61109 is my zip, and I want to do what we can on that
zip. Would you like several, or?
Yes, multiple.
Okay. I can do that.
Great. And then as it relates to the Career Awareness Committee, I've got a formal request hanging out there from December for the results of the Academy Expo surveys. Any idea when I can expect that?
That was provided to Mary Call, who I believe will be providing that information to you with the survey results for the Career Expo.
To who? I'm sorry.
Mary Call in Communications.
Oh, Mary. Okay.
It'll be added to this week's weekly update.
Great. Okay. And then I pointed it out last time, so help me understand if there's been a difference in direction, because we are very clearly about college and career readiness, and I know you talked about additional training, but it really bothers me to see a slide like this that may potentially go to all of these people where we are only talking about college readiness. Is that all that we are talking about? And if we're not, then we need to change the header. That is the issue. Not all of our kids are college ready. I've said this to this committee before.
Mrs. Powers, we have a college awareness committee and we have a career awareness committee. And so
this is just focusing on college.
But we have another committee that focuses on
this is just
career.
Focusing
this
on
college.
This
one committee is just focusing on college and another committee is focusing on careers because we have a goal for college and career awareness.
Yes. Thank you.
You are, okay. Mr. Rollins.
To the Healthy Starts Committee, I see that one of the things you've been working on is a preschool for all analysis, and there was that sort of broader community meeting a month or 6 weeks ago, the outcome of which would be there should be sort of a broader committee formed with various people in the community to study that. I'm just curious where ownership of this is really going to land, and is this something that you guys are doing? Is it something we're doing internally? Is it something we're creating this broader committee? Who's actually going to be taking ownership of this issue to do that analysis?
Well, I think we're still working on what we'd like to do is invite some of the members that have said that they were interested. There were actually two groups that were formed. One was kind of that enrollment kind of committee and making access available, and then how to pull the organizations together to just look at our capacity and how we can all, you know, get as many kids in as possible. So we have the names, Teresa Fillers and I, both school district employees have the names of the committees. We sent out an email letting them know that we'll be getting in touch with them soon. Our initial thought was we've got the preschool or the Healthy Starts Committee working on data analysis and doing some of that work already. We'd like to have an informational meeting with the group that said they wanted to work on this and share the process that we use with this and look at Healthy Starts as a potential place to work on that and do that work together because we already have a lot of community support there. I know that there might be some other things working on too. So. We're kind of in the planning process on that. But we have the names of the people identified. We needed to get our preschool ITP out for enrollment. We're kind of trying to get in ahead of, you know, people thinking about other locations as well for enrolling their students in preschool. Does that help? There hasn't been a real decision made, to my knowledge. We're in the process of working that through and looking at this as a possible process to use.
I guess my concern is that we'll end up with multiple entities looking,
right,
doing the same thing, and
right,
I don't want to see that happen. So if there's going to be a handoff, you know, I hope it's a good transition. I hope there is a handoff. I hope it's a clear handoff, and I hope there's
that having multiple people do it is a concern too. We're aware of that. I'm very aware of that. So we're trying to figure out a way to use this structure and process to start that, continue, actually say, not start it, continue the conversation with the community. We've invited some members from some of the child care facilities and things like that to join our committee as well, because they're big players in this.
Mr. Connor, I think you're next.
Mine is more of a comment. First, thank you all for taking your time and your expertise and to everybody, to Alignment Rockford and all the folks that do this, because this does take a lot of time, and I know a lot of you take your professional skills and apply them, so I want to say thank you. And just say personally that I have one of my sisters-in-law is a volunteer on the Healthy Starts, and so I know how much time it takes, and she takes her expertise. So again, to all of you, and especially to the volunteers, thank you very much. I know it's time consuming, so really appreciate it. Thank you.
Ms. Jackson, I think you had your light on, did you?
Yes.
Okay.
And this may go along with what Mr. Rollins asked, but Preschool for All is a priority. How does the work of this committee align with that, and then the development of a strategic plan? That's something that we're doing, right, developing that strategic plan. How are you aligning?
Well, for the Healthy Starts Committee, Glenn and I are co-chairing that, and we are bringing information together and doing this data analysis, which I did use when looking at the board priority information that was presented in January. This committee helped us pull that data together. The committee is all about developing solutions, and so we are currently looking even at the transportation issue and trying to see if there's other community resources and things like that. The committee is looking at tactics that could support our Preschool for All program and things like that. So we're still in that solution design place in the planning process, I guess, to say. But one of the things that came out of this was that as we were talking through the data, we noticed we had under-enrolled areas. And so rather than waiting to come up with the grand design of what this is going to look like long-term, we needed to develop a solution to get information out into the database that Alignment has to see if we had organizations that would be willing to host our Child Find sites. We want to reach the kids that need us the most that may not know how to find us or have access to get there. So we quickly put, as we went through this data analysis, this invitation to participate. That's where we're at, but we're still looking at preschool as a whole and all the different moving parts that really encompass what early childhood looks like in the community.
What's the biggest barrier?
I would say transportation from our data analysis. Transportation and just knowing that we're there, access.
Elaborate on the tactics.
Well, the tactic that we're looking at right now is just the Preschool for All invitation to participate. This will be going out once we have our operating board approval. It'll be going out to their database, which is what?
3,000?
Approximately 3,000 organizations. And what we're asking is for them to put our enrollment flyers, our how to enroll, just information about our program out in their businesses, their organizations, whether it's in a workroom or whether they have a place they can display public information. But then the second part of that is asking them if they'd be willing to host us on site. Are they a daycare organization that have children that are going to be rolling up, you know, into the right age range to participate in our program? Or is it a social service agency? Is it a church organization, a faith-based, where they know that they have young children there and they may have families not accessing us? So what we want to do is bring 205 to those sites and take care of it all at once on site. So we'd engage the community into helping us advertise that for that location, say it's a faith-based location. It helped them engage their congregation, the people that live in that area, let them know, you know, help us publicize it, that we're going to be there to do that, and then we'll go ahead and screen and enroll and get all the paperwork done on site. So they don't have to come to us down on Christina Street.
Will offer the services then? They'll have
no, they're not going to offer the services. We're going to just go there to screen and enroll. It's a child find.
Transportation is still the issue. So if you can do that, but if we still can't get over that barrier of transportation.
Mm-hmm. And we've been currently looking at some other things to help support that. They're just kind of in the information gathering stage. We've been talking with Rockford Mass Transit and some other things, looking at bus routing and different ways that we could potentially offer parents a different way to get to school if they'd be interested in doing that.
If I could just interject briefly, you know, one of the things I'm really pleased with is in the time that the committee has existed and then under Kim's leadership, we've gone from just over 2,000 students receiving services to over 2,600 students receiving services. So we're making some significant progress, and I want to make sure the board is aware of that. So about 85% of our students now arrive with a preschool experience as opposed to 75% of our students. Funding is another barrier. I appreciate your modesty saying that transportation is the core issue. We are full. You know, we are not running with excess seats, and the state funds us on a limited level, and we're actually squeezing about 300 or 400 more students into our service. We've also partnered with Head Start to expand access. So the group's doing some really good work, but I would also add that not only is transportation a core issue, but we also have a core issue with the fact that this is not funded either federally or at the state level or legally allowed to be funded on a large scale at the local level. So that's part of our issue as well. It's a coordination issue, but it's also a transportation issue, and it's certainly also a funding issue.
Okay, Ms. McCulloch.
But having said that we are full, at last time I asked, and this may have changed because I do know that there is some movement on that, we don't have a waiting list.
We do not have a waiting list right now. One of the things, we have some openings, and some of those openings are in very specific area, bilingual Spanish, special education openings. We also have a high transient population, so we may be full at one point, and then students move, they go missing. We have a high homeless population, so we're constantly enrolling. So if we lose a student, we replace a student.
Right. My point is merely that. I don't want to hear people say that we're full and so they don't even make an attempt. There's movement and we'll try to accommodate. And as you said, there's attrition. And so encourage.
We may, after this little invitation to participate, have a waiting list. That's my hope. Is that we find enough students and then get the students in that need us the most.
Any other questions or comments? Great job. Thank you for being here. Ms. McCulloch, you may now give the Education Committee report.
The Education Committee met in this room Monday, February 3rd. We started off with, we always start off since last February, we've added a public comment section to our board, a committee, to our agenda. And we very seldom have people come to speak to us, but we did this week. And one of the things that our script says when we invite people to speak is that for the education committee, is that it needs to pertain to agenda items. That's been on there since I was given the script back in February of 2013. And this was the first time I think I've had a speaker stand up who wanted to talk about something that wasn't on the agenda. And so that person didn't speak, and I went back to legal counsel and asked about the legality of that. And I was told that, according to the Open Meetings Act, public bodies may impose reasonable time, place, and manner and rules and regulations that are content neutral, narrowly tailored to serve a significant governmental interest and leave open ample opportunity or alternative channels of communication. Courts have found time limits on public comments to be reasonable. Likewise, public comments limited to the subjects on the agenda have also been found to be reasonable, and there were cases cited. Regardless of that, I've asked and will be accommodated with a new script for the Education Committee when people want to speak during public comment time, and there will be no restrictions. So I've already apologized to the individual who was there and asked them to please feel free to come back with their questions, and that will begin on our next meeting, which is March 3rd. I would like to draw everybody's attention. I don't know if it's still on the screen, but we're trying really hard to be not just transparent, but to help people follow along when we have meetings. So when we have both board meetings and committee meetings, all of the documents that are associated with the meeting are on the Board Docs website. So we're trying to get that Board Docs website up on the screen during the meeting and during the Ed Committee meetings. And I would just say that when it's under Education Committee, you would actually have to go to the tab that says Library. And then under that, there's Ed Committee, and then you would go to the date. And we'd encourage anybody who doesn't have access to a computer to contact the board secretary. We can try to help you with hard copies unless it becomes over abundant in terms of requests to our secretary. And we can look at that again, but at least we want to try to get people to follow along with what we're doing. The agenda that day had four items on it. We had an opportunity to ask additional questions about the charter school from Mr. Wiesman. There were none. We were introduced to a new pilot program that's going to hopefully start at Jefferson next year for 50 students. It's a math literacy program. It's basically the class that students take. If a student tests into, say, Rock Valley and takes the AccuPlacer test, and doesn't score high enough to start in their 100-level math class, they have to take a remedial class, and that is 98. What this program will be is we're going to offer that class, that 98, to 50 students at Jefferson High School. The way that they're offering it is students who score between a 15 and a 17 on the ACT test. And it's my understanding that we have about, one of the problems is that we only have to take 3 years of math in this district, and so many students don't take a senior level math class. 40% of our students do not take math their senior year, so they kind of have a gap year, and they're not prepared when they enter college. And actually, they did some math for us, and they showed us that, in essence, 7.7% of our students score high enough to be ready for advanced level math when they enter college. And, or actually entry-level math. So that came to our committee, and the committee was supportive of the program and asked that, supported it when it comes to the board. It is not on the agenda tonight, but I'll remind you of that when it does come forward. Another item that we looked at was a special education update, which was given by Mrs. Cyrus. I have notes, but I've got too many pieces of paper. What we looked at were numbers of special ed students. The expenditure right this last year for special education in this district out of our $404 million budget was $78 million. Of that, we spend, there's $7.2 million, which is spent for students who go to therapeutic day schools. In other words, we pay tuition to other schools to educate students with some special education back, not all of our special education students, obviously. But we do receive $5.4 million in reimbursement from the state for that, so the actual cost to this district is about $1.8 million. One of the things that we have been working on to be in compliance with the state's objective is to have more of our special education students in general education classes. There is a timeline in terms of how many percent we should be moving each year into that, and we actually are in excess of our special education students who are in general education classes 80% of the day. The state wanted us to have 52%, and we are actually at 60%. So the other piece of information that was of interest is they showed us ISAT scores for the special ed students and the general population. And while there was a space between the two, meaning the line for the special education student was lower, they did parallel each other. So when there was a drop, for example, or a raise, it seems that it followed the same in the general ed population. The last item on our agenda was the driver's education update. We changed our driver's ed program this past year to try to accommodate more students. In the 2011-12 school year, we accommodated 165 behind the wheel and 180 in the classroom. And this year was 721 behind the wheel and 817 in the classroom. The net cost went down, despite the fact that we almost tripled the number of students we worked with. The net cost went down from $54,000 to $133,000. The cost per student was $186 this year based on the 721 students. If you compare that to to the 2011-12 school year, it was $934 per student, and that was based on 165 students. So we served 45.3% of the students. This past year, 2 years ago, we only were able to serve 10.4%. And the reason that we were able to make those changes is instead of having our driver's ed teachers who are in the classroom also provide all the driver's ed behind the wheel for our students, we have been hiring private driver's education teachers and retired teachers who teach driver's education to do the behind the wheel portion at an hourly stipend. So our driver's education teachers are focusing just on the classroom portion. And they're hoping to do some night school in the fourth quarter. And they also offered in the summer. So they've made some progress, not only saving the district money, but also providing what is needed to a greater number of students. We're going to meet again, as I said, on March 3rd in this room. We originally were the 10th, but now that Casimir Pulaski is no longer a day off, we've moved ourselves back to our regular first Monday meeting of the month. And that concludes my report.
Thank you. Mr. Rollins, the Operations Committee report.
The Operations Committee met in this room on Tuesday, February 4th, which is just a week ago today. We discussed the selection of the second network on the group health plan. That's for six of the seven bargaining units, as well as the non-bargained employees. And the committee had, we've already approved that as part of the consent agenda, but the committee had unanimously recommended that to the board with one abstention. We received and reviewed the quarterly custodial report from Mr. Schmidt. That is a sort of a survey of our building principals on the job that they think that our custodians are doing, our custodial contractor, GCA. And there are some metrics there. And I also learned that we've hired a custodial supervisor who will be assisting that with that in the future. And also sort of reviewing the work that GCA does and evaluating it. Received the Nutrition Services Free Reduced Lunch Verification Report. That's a Department of Agriculture program. The regulations require that every year we randomly audit 3% of the people who are on free or reduced lunch other than direct certifications, 3% and no more than 3%. So we review the results of that audit just as we do every year. We reviewed a draft of the facilities rentals policy. That's something that we've been discussing both at the board level and at the operations committee level. We looked at the draft, and so the draft described sort of two categories of users, people who would be able to use the facilities for free and people who would be able to use it at our cost. And there was a discussion, and the thought was that we should contemplate a third category of users, people whom we might charge market rate for. And so we asked the administration to take that back and bring it back to the committee in March with a third category of users where we would at least have the opportunity to charge market rate for the use of our facilities. So that should be coming back in March. Looked at the facilities master plan capital and life safety projects updates. Most of that was just a review. A lot of this is available on the website. The one thing that I wanted to just point out was that the Auburn Fieldhouse upgrades is on the board agenda as an action, not as an action item, as a first reading tonight. But I did want to say that that was an item, which we'll talk about more when it comes up, but that was unanimously recommended to the board by the operations committee. A little bit here and get to the last. Student fees, Mr. Lewis just gave us an overview of what we've collected on student fees for the past few years. The amount, the total aggregate amount, has been going down. It's actually significantly below where it was 4 or 5 years ago. There was no recommendation. That was just an informational item. He talked a little bit about the their stand on the proposed budget for next fiscal year with the Budget and Finance Subcommittee. Then we talked about the proposed intergovernmental agreement with the City of Rockford, which is also on the board agenda as a first reading tonight. And he, after I think a significant amount of discussion at the committee level, and there were representatives from the city there, the recommendation from the committee with one abstention was otherwise unanimous that we consider that concept, or that we do something. We did not talk about the specifics of the IGA. There was a draft IGA in front of us, but we instead just kept it at a conceptual level, and the recommendation of the committee was that the board consider doing something along those lines. Well, we did talk about under new business starting to prepare a schedule for facilities maintenance and capital replacements. You know, certainly as we develop the facilities plan, one of the comments that I heard, and I think other people heard as well, is, well, how do we know that you won't just let the facilities fall into disrepair again? And I would like to show that we're not going to allow that to happen, or at least that we have a schedule in place for regular repair, replacement, improvements of the facilities going forward, that we'll budget for that every year. And the first step for that is to, I think, develop a comprehensive maintenance schedule for the facilities. And the administration has already started that process, and we just asked them to start bringing that through the operations committee so it's a little more public. The operations committee is regularly scheduled to meet on Tuesday, March 4th at 5:30. There's been some discussion about a special board meeting that night. I'm not sure where we landed on that. So I guess I won't say for sure that we're meeting that night for now, but if we don't meet that night, then, you know, we'll figure out a different night to meet.
Ms. McCullough.
And I apologize, I didn't hear the meeting, but could you, you said you had the results of the free and reduced lunch. Sir, what percentage were found to be?
The percentage has actually been going down over the past few years, so that's a good trend line. I think, I'm doing this by memory because I don't have the numbers in front of me. I think it was at 58%, so 58% of the 3% that were audited were found not to be eligible for free or reduced, and were moved from one of the two categories over to denied. 2 years ago, that percentage was in the 70s, so it's coming down.
But we still have 58% of the ones that are that we have audited that we find do not fall within the category that the application has been made.
Correct.
Okay. Which I just would reflect to people that when we see a 78 free and reduced lunch, is it 79% this year, I believe, sir?
79.6.
That perhaps some people who have applied have done so with inaccurate information, and so our community of students may not really be at that level at 79.6. Thanks.
Just to be accurate, mostly for the people who are listening on Channel 20, we only audit the people who are not direct certifications. So there is a large chunk of the people who are on the free or reduced lunch program who are what are called direct certifications, and there's various qualifications for that. So we're not, that audit isn't of the entire universe of people who are on free or reduced lunch. It's of a subset of that universe. And so if you're going to extrapolate, you have to be a little bit careful about how you do your extrapolations, but basic point is valid.
I just wanted to clarify for Mr. Wiesman if we've decided to move the charter school special board meeting and keep the ops meeting the same date as it should be, okay? And that, have we picked that date, and we have to notice about that, right?
Correct. We haven't picked the date yet. We do have to provide public notice a week and a half beforehand. It'll probably just get pushed to April.
Okay. Questions for Mr. Rollins? If not, we have one action item tonight, and that is the Rockford Arts and Education Grant Evaluation Agreement. This was presented by Mrs. Cyrus, I think, for Dr. Wolf. And so this is the, I need a motion and a second to approve the evaluation agreement for the Arts in Education grant.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor. Is there a second?
Yeah.
Second by Mr. Rollins. Are there any questions or discussions? Ms. Jackson. I think Dr. Wolf is in the back there.
These are all duplicates in our packet because there are several. I don't know if they were different or if they're just, it looks like it's saying the same thing.
I'm not sure exactly what was in your packet. We did revise the amount for this one, and there might also be a similar looking grant because our 21st Century program at Val is done by the University of Illinois College of Medicine at Rockford. The total that we're asking for is $13,444. It's a little bit under $6,000 under what is in the grant budget with the Rockford Arts and Education grant that the board received. The initial contract that came to the board was for $9,044. When we had a follow-up meeting with the evaluation team, we added a layer of research that hadn't been in there, which is why the cost went up some. We wanted to address if we did more visual arts, did that help students more performing arts? And that was not in the original contract that came to the board 2 weeks ago. It's been added in, and legal counsel said we could update that amount.
Paperwork still has the 944, so that's not updated. The administrative recommendation.
I kneeled before somebody and we changed it online, and I have to defer to her on that.
This evaluation is a requirement to have an outside evaluator.
Correct.
To meet the requirements of this grant. That's
correct. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, the U.S. Department of Education requires an outside evaluator. Okay. The University of Illinois College of Medicine has partnered with us on a variety of grant evaluations over the years, which is why we went with them. The U.S. Department of Ed approved up to $20,000 for the outside evaluation, and we believe we'll bring it in at $13,444.
Any other questions or discussion on this topic? If not, I'll have the coordinator call the roll on the motion to approve the Rockford Arts and Education Grant Evaluation Agreement. Yes. We have been advised by legal counsel that we're going to pull this because there are some inaccuracies in the paperwork. So we will move this to our next board meeting. Okay. Thank you. Under new business tonight, our first agenda item under new business or other business is the Youth Court Intergovernmental Agreement. And Mrs. Holdley, you're going to present that, I think.
What's before you tonight is what was negotiated with the county and the city for the youth court program. This is a program that has been at the initiation stage since last summer. There's been a large group of folks, including the YSN, present at the table to discuss and put together the program. The role of, or my particular role, was to look at a intergovernmental agreement to outline how this program would work in a general sense. So how would the parties share information and who would be responsible for what part. I do want you to know that YSN did receive a grant that will be used for the training purposes and implementation of the program for 3 years. And after that, then the board would have to make a decision whether it wanted to continue funding it, because according to the agreement, we have a certain responsibility for funding the program in the event that it continues.
Do we have any idea what we think that might be in amount?
It would be ongoing training costs, essentially, so I'm not sure what exactly that would look like then, because the initial startup costs obviously are much more.
Ms. Powers.
So there's some irregularities here too, in that the contract says students who commit certain offenses which would otherwise involve, the cover says which may involve. I'd prefer that if it says one thing in the contract, that the summary says the same things. I guess, what can we expect in terms of the timing of what would be our, I'm assuming the district's administrative regulations, as well as what then is being communicated to specifically the policemen that are currently in our schools, and their training and kind of their requirements? What can we expect in terms of the timing for the first draft of those?
There wouldn't really be administrative regulations associated with this. There's a program associated with it. So that would be what the students are trained on, and what staff members who are helping implement this would be implementing. But that wouldn't be an administrative regulation. As far as what the police and the communication with the police, that's part of what we're doing right now. The Rockford City Police are also on this task force that's meeting monthly. And so Sergeant Spellman is there, or Deputy Chief Sweeney is present as well. So they kind of switch off. But they're both heavily involved in this program. That would be up to them as far as how they're going to train their officers, because really what the role of the police officer doesn't change. The only part that they're really going to be doing differently is helping to communicate to parents and to the student offenders certain information about the program. So they're helping to facilitate that. That's the only thing that's different from what they would be doing currently.
The administrative regulations. This is something that I would like to see consistency and execution from school to school, and that we have a population of students that reflects the students of our population. I don't want that to be left up to any interpretation. So I would prefer that we do have administrative regulations about how we take this program to market, for lack of a better word. I don't want to leave it subject to principal interpretation, or even worse, that if it's going to be delegated to a staff member to work as the sponsor to train and work with these children, I'd like to know who we hold accountable for ensuring that there is the level of confidentiality and all the other things that go with this. I'm not comfortable in leaving it to they're going to be trained.
All right, so it's a terminology. It's like the board policy is a specific terminology. Administrative regulation is a specific terminology. When you're talking about program guidelines and procedures, that's what would be in place. It's not really an administrative regulation. An administrative regulation is put in place to enforce a board policy, or to set, or to give more guidance on a board policy. So I think what you're talking about are the program guidelines, which, yes, would be in place.
So when could we expect then the first draft of the program regulations, and who will be drafting those from our side or providing input to those?
That's what Mr. Carson's group is working on as part of that committee, and Ms. Cronus here.
So can you,
I'm looking for next steps. So we approve this at our next board meeting, then what? What are the sequence of activities that happen after that? When could we expect to see the initial round of program guidelines and a timeline for communication and training of respective parties?
So the program that we're using is the from this Court, the Center for Core Innovation, and I think in the Ed Committee update, I had the references there, which I'd be more than happy to give to you again, and the timeline of the rollout of what we're looking at, starting with a pilot program at one school to make sure that it's, you know, going the way that we want it to go.
Right. In the Ed Committee documents, the portion about the police was a gap. I'm still concerned that our policemen that are in our buildings today have the proper training for this. It was not covered in the documents that you provided.
Okay, so I could, that has been covered, as Mrs. Oldley said, that Chief Sweeney has been on the committee and has committed that those police officers would be trained in accordance with, you know, basically they're not doing anything different, like she said, but it would just be the notification piece of the option to go into youth court. So I would be happy to, you know, have them address that to you, because that's not really anything that we can do, but we can ask them to address that.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Ms. Jackson.
I do have a question on, I'm going to call it page one of the agreement. It says, the party shall agree with the approval of the state's attorney to a list of potential offenses.
It's item number three.
It's available.
As far as I know, right now, the state's attorney is still working on the list of offenses. It's completely at their discretion. It's not, you know, anything that we have any input into. They would be minor infractions.
To know what those are as a board member. So are you going to get those?
I can't.
You expect to get that list?
Can I ask? I have, Wendy Vaughn has been chairing the committee from the community side. She's a clinical law professor at NIU, and she runs the Zeke Georgie Legal Clinic. So I'm going to defer to her if that's okay with you.
Thanks, Gina. Hi, everyone. I'm Wendy Vaughn. So just to address both of those questions, there is a group of lawyers who've been meeting from the city of Rockford, from the state's attorney's office, from the school district, to work on the policies and procedures that Ms. Powers inquired about, as well as this list of infractions. And as Ms. Corona mentioned, the youth court program is a diversionary program, and so the gatekeeper for which students are eligible to participate in the program comes solely at the discretion of the state's attorney's office. And so we have been working very closely with them to talk about what kinds of infractions should be included on that list. So we will absolutely have a list, and we can certainly provide that to you, Ms. Jackson. I can't give you a specific timeline or a date by which we can give you that, because it would depend upon Attorney Bruscato giving us that finalized list. But I know that they've been working on it, and they've had a number of discussions about the list, and I'd be happy to share that with you as soon as we have that. Certainly we'll have that list before the pilot project is implemented, as well as the procedures governing how the program will actually operate before it is implemented.
Could I have you turn your mic on? Thank you.
That students can only go through this once, whether successful or unsuccessful. Whose is that?
And so, again, that is the requirement of the state's attorney himself. And so it is a topic that we discussed at great length. And we've talked about that particular provision as it relates to offenses that would otherwise be chargeable as crimes under the Juvenile Court Act. And so certainly there were many members of our committee that took issue with that particular provision. But again, because it's a diversion program that is at the sole discretion of the state's attorney's office in terms of figuring out which students are eligible or not, it was not something that we could negotiate. Yes, really. We hope to continue to seek outside funding. So there's a possibility of applying for an additional 2 years of funding through the Community Foundation itself. And certainly when the Community Foundation presented the funding to the Youth Services Network, the board members who made that presentation did reference the possibility of an additional 2 years of funding from that source. As well, our hope is that the committee, once we have this pilot project implemented, could turn to looking at other sustainable sources, if at all possible, to relieve the district of any financial burdens later. I can't promise what that would be, but certainly the three-year operation of the grant exceeds the period of time for which this intergovernmental agreement covers.
It appears that the state's attorney's office really has authority over the decision making. So as a district, what do we have authority over when it comes to the implementation of this program? Can you?
I can address that. There's very limited authority that we have. What the piece that we are really handling is with the youth that are selected and trained for this program, then what they would do is implement the restorative justice piece of it. So when youth are charged with a crime and then they're diverted to this particular program, our role then would be, the district's role would be to identify restorative justice possibilities or now, the different things that the student might have to do. For example, it could be a community service, or it could be writing a letter of apology, or things along those lines. And there's a whole list that the committee has been presented with possibilities, but they're still finalizing all of those. And it's essentially just providing a means to make reparation and for students, and to avoid an actual criminal charge a criminal charge on their record.
It appears at least once, because they can only go through the program whether successful or unsuccessful
right
on time.
And, actually, while you said we couldn't negotiate it, we certainly tried to negotiate it, but that was something that the state's attorney's office was very firm on. One of the things, though, that we did accept out is because there's various ordinance violations. They're not really criminal prosecution, but various ordinance violations such as smoking, and they could go through the program a number of times for that. There's no limit on that. It's really just the piece where the state's attorney controls it. So it's really to help try to keep a student from being prohibited and engaging in, for example, the military. They would look at arrests and convictions. And so it's things like that where this would help out, as well as stopping a student from having to go through the criminal justice system through the traditional means.
So we'll have to be MOU signed, right? Because we're going to be sharing. As a district, we're going to be handing over sensitive student information, right?
I don't know what you mean by MOUs. The statute references that we're talking about in the government, in the intergovernmental agreement, address that sharing of information. I think what you're talking about is what would the student and parent receive, and there are notices and signatures that would have to be obtained where they're voluntarily agreeing to this restorative justice program. So they would be agreeing to go to youth court. And all of the notices in there would, all of the notices that are applicable to this program would be included. For example, what happens when you fail to complete your assignment through the youth court program, and and the state's attorney was very explicit in ensuring that the police, when they give that notification, it includes if you don't complete it, you would be returned back to the traditional criminal justice prosecution.
So what part does YSN play? Because honestly, I thought this was their grant that they were implementing this. I had no idea that the state's attorney's office played such a role in this. So what's the role of YSN in this besides obtaining the grant?
YSN would be responsible for the training component of that, and that's where the dollars come in for helping to train the students on implementing this, as well as, I'm not sure, I haven't read that grant.
So YSN would also be responsible for providing a person at the school that would run the session in terms of having the peer jury organizing that. They would also be responsible for making sure that the student actually carried out whatever restorative sentence, for lack of a better word, that they're given, just to make sure that they actually do whatever it is that they're told to do or required to do. And then at the end, we would be having the students come back and report back to the peer jury as part of the restorative piece of it, and they would just be coordinating all of that.
Do you work for the district?
I do.
I'll let you jump in.
Mr. Rollins.
I think, in listening to the comments and the concerns, so the piece where it seems to me that we would need to get releases is some information is going to get reported to this peer group of students. And so I assume that part of it won't just be notices, but we will actually, as part of the voluntary participation in the program, having them sign releases so that that information can be given to the peer group. To Mrs. Power's point, I think the training has to do with her group and ensuring they understand the seriousness of ensuring of keeping the confidentiality of the information that's going to be disclosed to them.
That's correct.
Okay.
I do have one last question. Do you know, how did parents, did we do any type of parents find out about this? I mean, did we send something home saying we're going to implement this new program? How does this affect our code of conduct that we're going to be?
We're not sure that we're implementing it until you approve the agreement. So then notifications, and there would be various information shared with that. So right now it's still in the preliminary stages. So as far as parent communication, that still is a piece that has to happen. I think I just forgot your second. Oh, the code of conduct. That's separate and apart. That's something that you can look at in the future, but this is really part of the criminal justice system. It's not part of our code of conduct.
But we do have some of those things like peer jury, circle groups. I mean, some of those elements are already in our.
Right, but this would be running parallel, similar to what happens currently when a student is, for example, consecutively charged with a theft and by the police and or victim, I should say, presses charges. And then also we deal with it from a student disciplinary purpose. Until really this program is up and running, we didn't feel comfortable putting the two together. Perhaps in the future, when we see how it's working and all of that, it might make sense to implement it jointly, but right now it's going to run concurrently.
Okay. One more question.
For Board Member McCulloch, when she's...
Go ahead. Ms. McCulloch, did you have a question? No?
No, I have one for Mrs. McCulloch.
Okay, all right, go ahead.
Okay. Do you get any background, I guess, statistics on youth court, like how it's maybe other cities that is in, any data, how successful it's been or not successful?
You did refer to some other areas that are doing it. Do you have that information for them?
It could be sent out. You could send it.
Yes, I'd be happy to. And we visited youth courts in Madison and in Aurora. There's also one being operated for the Harlem School District, currently Freeport. We spoke with
people from New York and Chicago. This is a pretty prolific program in a lot of different areas. We saw some really successful, cool stuff. I'd be happy to send out links to information.
To Madison, Wisconsin?
Mm-hmm.
And just for the record, it makes me a little leery because Madison, actually Wisconsin, has the highest rate of black male incarceration at 12.8%, almost double national average.
Yeah, and I would be happy to let you know, show you their statistics for what great things that it has done in the schools that it's in.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Our next item is the intergovernmental agreement with the City of Rockford regarding our property on Madison Street. So Mr. Schmidt is presenting that.
Yes, in your packet you have a draft intergovernmental agreement. What we're looking at is the City of Rockford and the Park District is looking at redeveloping the former Ingersoll Building on Water Street into an indoor sports complex. One of the things that they're looking at is a need for some additional parking out there. The school district happens to have 1.1 acres on 201 South Madison, which is the former administration building. What we're looking here is kind of doing a swap, a land swap with some in-kind services for and at the end of the day, given that building and that property, actually, the demolition of the building and the property over to the city. And in turn, the city would give us additional services of salt, yearly salt purchase, which we do from them. We have tree relocations, replanting that we're looking at doing throughout the district. We will get $30,000 a year for trees over the next 5 years. They will demo some land acquisition, some houses that we're looking at acquiring for $75,000. They will also vacate 9th Avenue over by East High School that we need for part of our field house addition. That's valued at $30,000. They'll put some sidewalks in over at Froberg. Froberg is one of the areas of the city where we have subdivisions right behind the facility, and we still have a bus route there because there are no sidewalks to the city. That will save us $15,000 to $20,000 a year in reducing a bus route and a bus and a bus driver. Also on this, we'll save, we have the carrying costs. We have approximately $40,000 a year with utilities, and then we have some liability insurance premiums that we're carrying on that building. So basically, as a whole, we're looking at budgetary numbers for the abatement and demolition with some contingencies and escalation in there at $725,000, where it would be capped at $725,000 until we actually got the actual bids in here. And in turn, the City of Rockford would give us in-kind services over the next 5 years equivalent to that $725,000. If it comes in at $700,000, then the city would basically give us $700,000 worth of services. Any questions?
Mrs. Powers.
So when I add up the numbers that are part of the agreement, there's a $500,000 gap between the 725 and the city's services. Is that seriously $500,000 worth of salt?
No, what we're looking at, if you look, we're looking at over a 5 year payback on this thing. So if we're looking at salt, we're looking at 2,500 tons at $65 a ton. That's over the 5 years. That comes up to about $162,500 over 5 years. With the trees, it's at $30,000 a year, so over 5 years, it's $150,000. Just to give you a little side on the trees, with our current renovation projects that are underway right now, we've uprooted 50 trees, and at East, we're looking at about 100 trees. Plus, we've done an extensive inventory of all our trees, where we have a little over 300 ash trees that we need to replace. So those trees are actually beneficial for the district. The demo is 75.
Got it. So they're all on an annual basis.
Yes.
75
for the is the demo.
Okay. I'm sorry. Keep going through them. Okay.
Yeah. So 75,000 is for the demo. That's a single. The 9th Street or 9th Avenue vacate, that's 30,000. That's a single. The Froberg, for the 90,000 that they're putting up in front there, that's a single purchase. The ones that we're looking over multi-year would be the trees and the salt. We have insurance with the liability on that building. That's approximately $2,200 a year. That's $11,090 over 5 years. Froberg, we're looking at $15,000 a year in savings. That's $75,000 over 5 years. And then with our carrying cost of our utilities at $40,000 a year over 5 years, that's about $200,000. And actually, that all adds up to about $793,000 or something.
Okay. And then my other question is, that building has sat there for 2 years. Why are we all of a sudden, I feel very pushed and rushed to get this done?
Part of this is the city came forward to us a couple weeks ago, and Mr. Ryan, he's in the audience right there, if he has anything to say about this. That's part of some of the things that they're working on with their bonding structure for the whole complex out there. And part of that is we've been slowly taking things out of there. We've had the theater department out at Auburn High School come out there and take a lot of things for their stage prop. We've moved our equipment out of there. And the lower level, basically in the basement, we still have a few things that are still stored out there.
So given that there's asbestos, I mean, how accurate is that? I mean, what's the benefit of taking, granted, an experienced estimate from you as compared to just getting an actual, put it out to bid and know exactly what our exposure is? Why?
Actually, the estimate for the abatement was from a licensed contractor that we do have on staff that the board approved, Conobear Associations, to do asbestos abatement and remedial design for the district. And this is based off of their estimate. Yes, we will go out the bid, but they're the ones that give us the initial budgetary estimates because they're going to do the design work for the abatement and help us create the bid documents to send it out for abatement. And then we also actually got a contractor to give us an estimate of tearing down and demolitioning the building. And then we in turn added contingency, 10% contingency on there, and some escalation costs in there too, which is our standard. So those were actual that we have received from contractors that we have used before for this type of work. It's going to take us some time to sit there and develop the specifics on the abatement documents and the demo documents, and we won't be able to have those out the bid for 30 to 60 days, and then those will be out on the street. So that's kind of why we're looking at right now. So we actually did get some contractors to give us an estimated in there, and that's why we put that in there in that intergovernmental agreement that it's capped at $725 for the cost of the district.
Understood, but they want to start this agreement March 1st, and you're saying that we wouldn't even have the bids out on the street for another 30 to 60 days from now?
Yes.
I mean, so we're into this agreement, and I guess the other piece of it that I would like to see spelled out is, you know, so far, a lot of the bids for all of the building remodels and things have come in under budget. I would really like to know what the process is for determining what gets cut and how that works so that it's not just at their discretion. I agree. I see that it says that it will be mutually agreed upon, but you know, the sequence of what gets cut first and those kinds of things, I'd like to have in advance, you know, what the priority is from this group of people that are approving it. Okay. And then the last comment is that there aren't any attachments. So I really don't like feeling rushed when I don't have all of the information.
What was the attachment? Oh, it was the aerial view of 201 South Madison and the sidewalk on Frober. Yes.
Ms. McCullough.
I'd reiterate that I don't know what's the hurry. We've had that building for 2 years. The city's been working on their project for however long. So to now try to do this in 2 weeks, I personally would rather see the accurate bid to go on so that we know and that we can do an even exchange. So that, as Ms. Power said, if we have to back off somewhere, we make sure that we're backing off what we want to do back off on. There are things, there are gaps that I'm not sure of. It says structure. There's a parking lot there. Who's taking care of the parking lot? How much is supposed to be part of the, what are our specs on what we're bringing the site up to? I personally, if it ends up going over, do not wish to, excuse me, I don't think you've been asked to come up to the podium yet. I do not think that, I do not personally wish this board to have to review this, you know, bring it back to us again and say, oh, it went over, our bid was this, we only did it for this much money, it's over the 5% contingency, let's bring it back to the board for another vote. Look, board, it's only another $10,000. I would like to approve, and I totally agree, I support the concept. The operations committee supported the concept, but the reason we have a working committee, the reason we have the operations committee, just like we have the education committee, is that things like these are brought to the working committee to be vetted by the members of that committee, both community and board, so that when it comes to me as a board member, I know that they've given it the time and recognition that it's needed. So you just said it's, the address is 201, the address on all the documents is 215, so I'm not sure what the address is even. One of the things that's on there that really is a little bothersome to me is, and I think it's great, there are things we need salt, we need trees, you know, what if we don't use all our salt in the first 5 years, are they just gonna dump a bunch of extra salt on us, all those pieces? But one of the things on there that really sticks out to me, I was on this board when we approved going to our different, to neighborhood schools. And when we were going to neighborhood schools, we identified the fact that there wasn't a sidewalk there for Froberg. And the city said they had some sort of grant and they were gonna take care of it and they were gonna put a sidewalk in. And now we're coming back and we're paying for the sidewalk. I mean, it's our $90,000 that it's gonna pay for that sidewalk. Part of which is not even on our property, it's on 20th Street, right? On an easement that is part of the city's property. So it bothers me that we're considering that an even trade when it's something I think is the responsibility of the city. I did note in here on redlined out that we were hoping to get some sidewalks over at Auburn. Again, I don't really want to be paying for sidewalks because I think that's part of the city's responsibility to help the district and to help this community by having safe passage to and from schools, and yet we're being asked to pay for that. So let me list three things that I saw in the check register tonight that the city, that we are paying the city for that aren't even listed in there. We pay the city, let's see, police services this month, $281,000. We paid the city, the water department, $12,106,000. And we paid the city of Rockford $600 because we had kids pulling fire alarms and we have to pay them $100 each time they come out for a false alarm. So I see some really great swaps, but I also see, you know, at least one that's glaring to me that was a promise of the city that they're not following through on, they're asking us to pay for, that could easily be covered by another area. That is a true savings to the district. So with all that in mind, I'm gonna make a motion. We'll just see what the rest of the group feels. And I'd like to make a motion to direct the administration to secure a bid for the environmental remediation, demolition, and design services for the structure at 201 or 215, whichever it is, South Madison Street, and use that bid in an IGA with the city to be vetted by operations committee prior to returning to the full Board of Education as an action item.
Second.
I have a motion on the floor. Is there a second? Ms. Powers? Any discussion or questions on the motion made by Ms. McCullough? Mr. Rollins.
I'm trying to sort of parse some of this out. So in terms of having it go through again through the operations committee, the operations committee was very supportive. In fact, I'll say that they were probably more supportive than probably the board members were. Oh, they're gonna support something that's even more expansive than this. It's not gonna help you any to send it back to the operations committee, and sending it back to the operations committee is gonna delay everything for another month or two. I guess before we vote on this, I'd like to know what the urgency is, what the timeline is, and not ideal for us to be asked in this type of a timeline, and I think it causes complications when we're asked to do that. But I, on the other hand, you know, if there's a good reason for it, I guess I'd like to know what that reason is. I'd like to have an opportunity to hear what that reason is, and before I make a decision.
Who would you like to ask that question of, the city or Mr. Schmidt?
Well, right now, I mean, we do have the city administrator here, so I think he'd be in the best position to tell us what the timeline is.
You could address Mr. Rollins' question.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, and we really appreciate you you taking the time to consider this item. From a standpoint of the timing, one of the things that is really imperative of this project is the parking. And when we look to go to the bond market this March, we really need to make sure that we have a project that our city council can get behind. And one of the critical items that not only the Park District feels about, but as well as city council and the community in terms of who we're working with, is to make sure that we have parking that is on site. When you look at the Ingersoll project, it's been empty since 2002. We have an empty board admin building, and we're really making a concerted effort as we go forward to take care of a lot of these abandoned buildings and put them into adaptive reuse. We were able to get state law changed to get a River Edge grant. Actually, there's four different grant sources to help fund this $21 million project. So when we look at why we need the parking, and I apologize that it is late in terms of trying to get your approval, but we really want to make sure that City Council has assurances that we have adequate parking so that when we go forward, this is going to be a successful project. With respect to Froberg, I don't know the history on that, but I certainly can understand your comments. I think, you know, in addition to that, we've also expended costs in terms of demolitions on several schools that, for whatever reason, in terms of, I know that you followed state statute and you conveyed the property to a third party, but many of them didn't work out. So we've incurred a considerable amount of dollars as well on vacant, abandoned schools.
What's the urgency, though, to get something completed and in place by March 1st? Is there any urgency, or, I mean, what would stop us from going out and getting a bid at this point to see what the actual demolition costs look like before we...
I think we would like to have the assurances that we have an intergovernmental agreement where we have terms outlined. We certainly are open to the fact that within the IGA, we can have a go, no go if we get bids and in fact they exceed $725,000. But we want to have an agreement that the district would convey the property for the purposes of moving this indoor sports complex forward.
Okay, so I'm going to ask the same question because I don't think you answered the question. What is the timeline that requires us to have voted on this by March, by the end of February? Why don't you take us through your timeline in terms of why it is critical? We vote on it, then what are you doing with your city council? And please tell me you're going to rush them the way you're rushing us. And then where does it go with the bond market? I haven't heard an answer to the question personally.
We are getting final estimates from our architects this Friday. Within the next 2 weeks, we plan on going to City Council to present a final project presentation in terms of the sources and uses. We'll then ask them to pass an ordinance to set a bond date, not only a bond hearing date, but also a bond sale date. So that will proceed within the next 30 to 45 days. So before, what I'm trying to say is before we go to the bond market, we want to make sure that we have the property acquired. Similarly to the property acquisition of the Board of Ed building, we also have an option on the Watch Factory property, which is adjacent to the Board of Ed building. Both of those are two critical pieces to move the project forward.
And I understand that, and you guys have been working on the project for a while. And again, conceptually, everybody's on board. It's just the fine, and I don't want the fine tuning to take place after we make, you know, we support it. I really feel as a board member and a taxpayer's advocate that we make sure that we, so to speak, cut the best deal with the city that is in the best interest of the district as well as the community. So conceptually community, but I don't think we've ironed out the money pieces. And I still don't understand why you can't go to the bond market a month later. I understand rates may change or whatever, but your sudden need to fast track this, what's the saying, your emergency is not my crisis. So why is it, A, you didn't bring it sooner, or B, what difference is a month going to make?
I don't think a month is going to be a deal breaker, but I think what our sense of urgency was is whatever critical path items that we have in terms of making sure that this project is a success, we're trying to nail down. It is a very difficult site, has a railroad that bifurcates it. We have a number of things that we need to do to get ready. This is a building that's costing the taxpayers money. We serve the same shareholder, and I think one of the things you've heard, two different items tonight that we've talked about that we're working in cooperation with the district on, the youth court. We have a partnership with the Head Start program. This is no different. We have joint purchasing agreements on SALT now. You know, as the operations committee said, this is a new way of thinking, and we really don't want to go and talk about the past. And you know, you mentioned Froberg. There were plenty of mistakes that were made, I think, by both units of local government, and we're trying to turn a new leaf here. And so when we look at this, we really feel that we want to get this done. A month is not going to kill us, I don't think, Ms. McCulloch, but we really want to get it done. In terms of the price, you had mentioned that you want to have a prioritization if it's lower than the demolition cost of $725. We don't have any problem with that. The issue, I think, that we're both concerned about, both parties, is if it goes over $725, and who would provide that. But ultimately, we want this to be a win-win for our taxpayers.
But it's all the more reason to make sure that we get an accurate bid if we're both concerned that it might go over. So I would be willing to adjust my amendment to say that, you know, we get that bid in place and that the IGA is written contingent on that bid as compared to having gone back to Ops Committee, as Mr. Rounds has said. He feels that we can fast track it to the board. In that way, we can accommodate your timeline in part, but instead of just us acting without a solid number here tonight, I'm going to keep my amendment on the floor, or my motion on the floor, to at least have the bid and then to return to the board with the IGA with the more accurate number. Would you be willing to support or second that change?
Second the amendment.
Okay. Any questions on the motion, the second? Mr. Rollins.
Just wanted to know from Mr. Schmidt, like, how quickly could we go out for bid on something like that and actually get the bids in and have them see what the numbers look like?
Yeah, as Mr. Lewis, we'll probably have the bids out there for at least a 30-day window. We're working with the city and their capital development department on the bid specs now.
The only thing I'd like to add, if I could, would be just there was a precaution that was added today to add a 5% risk the city was going to take on if it went above $725,000 into the contract, in addition to the contingencies that Mr. Schmidt. So the risks are negligible, but I do want to point out that, and then the other provision would be that if it went beyond that 5%, both parties could remove it. So we would not be committed to a higher price. And if it was within about $36,000 more, we wouldn't be committed to that. So I do think there was an attempt to address some of the issues that came up with that shorter timeline.
And I would, may I say just again to that, what I said earlier was that I don't want to vote on this twice. Let's get it right the first time. Let's everybody know what our part is, what our piece is, instead of coming back and saying, oh, it's just, you know, this, it's over by 40 or whatever, and the city's going to do 36, so now you only have 4. I mean, we just don't need to go there. Let's just have an agreement that is that has all the pieces in place. So I have all the questions.
Any other questions or comments? Mr. Rollins.
I'm still trying to sort this out. So I didn't really get an answer from you, Mr. Schmidt. So
I'm just trying to look. I'm trying to run the schedule here.
I understand. Can you be able to think that quickly, or? I mean, that came out differently than I meant it to. Can you run the schedule that quickly? And I know it depends on how quickly you can get the specs together, the specifications.
We're looking at least 45 days out before we can get bids back, a minimum. That's getting the developing the specs, make sure we're iron tight on the specs, do the testing, do the abatement, get that all back there, have it out on the street.
Okay, so you're talking 45-day minimum to get the bids back in, and that's going to have to come back for the board for a first reading or a second reading. And
no, that would be a bid, so that would be just like a normal bid.
I'm not talking about the bids. I'm talking about the IGA. is what we're talking about doing.
It would be an amendment, so amended contract, it would come back for a second.
So you're probably talking about 60 days. Is that going to cause you any sort of material problem at the city? 60-day play to get this hammered down, nailed down?
I think it causes the uncertainty of having city council trying to approve a $21 million project and not knowing and having assurances that we can provide adequate parking for the facility. And ultimately, that's what we want to make sure is a success. So under that scenario, Mr. Rollins, we would be going to the bond market without knowing if we have enough parking for the facility.
So you're going to go to the bond market anyway without this being nailed down? You couldn't just wait the 60 days to go to the bond market? Get approval from the city council for the project?
We are trying to target the opening of this facility for fall 2015. One of the reasons why this facility was thought of to begin with is that we lack the indoor facility and tournament venues and hotel room nights for the winter months. So that was our target date. So the more we push back the bond date, the more we're going to get into that season.
Any other questions?
I guess that's what I was trying to get at from the very beginning. So you've got an end date that you're targeting. Have you run timelines, and is this going to adversely affect that timeline to hit that target date? Is that what's going on, or do you think, I'm trying to find out from you, is the 60 days going to cause a problem or not?
As I mentioned, I think that our goal is to have the land acquisition locked up before we go to the bond market. Whether that is an IGA that has more generalities so that we can make sure that we have a locked-in bid price. What we've outlined in terms of the schedule of services is flexible enough that the district can pick and choose in terms of what services it would like to choose, whether or not the bid was lower than $725,000. We really wouldn't care from the city's perspective. But what we do feel strongly about is getting some surety in an intergovernmental agreement that we will be able to acquire the property.
Ms. Jackson.
I have to vote on board member McCulloch's motion, or
yes.
Can I ask questions, or what's the... It's not about her motion, it's about this that I'm looking at.
You can ask questions.
Okay, so why is the term for almost 5 years, why is the term of this IGA for almost 5 years? What's the purpose of a five-year agreement?
Mr. Schmidt?
That's where we kind of looked at it from some of the operational savings and working in conjunction with the city to help out with this project here. It gets our building demolished, it helps us with our carrying costs, and it gives us some free services for some of the materials over the next 5 years. Kind of looked at it as a whole package, as a five-year payback on us. Your microphone. Sorry.
So it'll take them 5 years to plant trees, to build sidewalks. Is that what we're saying?
Well, and part of that stuff is we don't need 2,500 tons of salt this year. We need some every single year, and we looked over the next 5 years. All the trees, we don't need them all right now. We need some as we go through our projects. So as we started mapping some of these things out, we looked at, say, okay, let's have a five-year intergovernmental agreement with this, so we look at everything over the course of 5 years.
Okay, and so I asked this at operations. When we, this building, we estimated demolition fees, and those were less than the $725,000, correct?
Yes, at that time we had some additional fees out there. It was a little over about $500,000, and that's why we have escalation and contingencies in there, and based on some of the new numbers, we're at about $725,000. We wanted to make sure that we had a fairly accurate budget number. We didn't want to go in and estimate it for $400,000.
We're saying we will have this demolished by November 1st, 2014. We'll report to the city by December 1st, 2014.
Yes.
So Attorney Hill, maybe you can explain it better, because I still have questions on the 5 years. Can that, do we have to have this for 5 years, even though we're going to get the services over the 5 years? That can't be written out that, because it's basically for them to, we're going to pay to demolish this building, plus outlined. It's more about the price aligning, so we're trying to match the 725 with the 725. Still don't understand why we have to enter for 5 years.
Correct, that we don't was need what trees was negotiated. At once. Right, that was what was negotiated. So it could be shorter. It can't be longer because the max is a 5-year agreement.
Dr. Hunter, did you have a question?
Yes, so we're supposed to finish it by November 1st. And if this gets delayed 60 days, can we still get it done by November 1st? So it's April, middle of April, and you still got, I don't know anything about demolishing big buildings, so.
Well, we put it in there if we would have this agreement that we would have it out there. It may delay it another month or so. Whatever it delays it here, it may delay it on the back end.
Lori, Ms. Holtley.
Actually, because you would be delaying it to put the bid out, then that piece would already be completed, so then you could accept the bid. At the same meeting, conceivably, as you approve the IGA. So it wouldn't necessarily delay it because you already are doing the 60-day work of putting out the bid.
I would just add, that wouldn't delay, you know, we would be able to get the building down. I mean, from a demolition standpoint, that wouldn't be the issue. I think the issue, again, just to reiterate, is getting the surety before we go out to the bond market that we're actually going to be able to get the property under the terms that we set forth.
Okay, Mr. Connor, you're next.
So my basic question is that if I'm hearing Mr. Ryan correctly, it's the commitment to the concept is what I'm hearing. And so I guess my question is, would the details make the difference on that, on whether we accept it or not? Is that the intention of the amendment, is that we would get a number back that would make it unacceptable?
Okay. Ms. McCullough,
so it's not the concept.
Not, and I've said that repeatedly. I absolutely
I understand
support
that,
the,
but
we could. I could be sitting up here saying, I think we need to go put this out on the public market and see if anybody wants to buy it first. I'm not saying that. I really support the idea of community and us working together, but I also am, I would like to, I just heard that, and I've forgotten that, Ms. Jackson, that it was going to be $500,000 to drop it, you know, when we bought this building. Now it's $725,000, and so sounds a little bit fluid. Let's make sure that we have the right number.
Maybe I didn't ask my question correctly then. Is if you're in favor of the concept, what I'm hearing is that the city would like us to commit to this on the concept side, and I'm still, where I'm struggling is, I don't know what kind of number you'd be expecting that would make this a no-go. So that's, I'm truly struggling on the delay side from that standpoint, because it sounds like we're, I mean, frankly, I'm going to give my opinion on this one. I think we're nitpicking this one a little bit, and what bothers me is, and I'm not, if the city's been behind, let's call them out on that, I got no problem on that, but I think I'm not sure what we're going to get on the delay unless somebody tells me, Mike, I'm voting no against this if it's a certain number. And because if it's a swap, we should be able to write language in here that says the deal's off if we don't agree with the swap. If that's the only issue, to me, that is very different than the concept. And so all I'd like to say is that if we like the concept, we should be able to write the terms and conditions so that the city would get some kind of assurance that we would do this, and we would just have a breaking point or something, because all I'm hearing is that's the only objection to going to the marketplace, is the for us to agree to the sale, unless I'm missing something.
Ms. Holdley.
I think what you're asking is whether or not if the delay to get the bid back would make a difference to the agreement. And as the agreement is written currently, yes, it would, because if it's over the 725, there is an opt-out provision for the city. So I would think that they're also interested in getting the bid as soon as possible so that they could, I know with them going to the bond market, it's still not a certainty until the bid comes back and they can make a decision.
Essentially, we're in the same position no matter what.
Mr. Ryan.
So the delay, I guess I'm still puzzled on the delay, because if we've still got that contingency no matter what, and we like the concept.
It should be covered.
Yeah, I don't.
Mr. Ryan.
If I may, as Attorney Holdley pointed out, not only do we have an opt-out provision so that we both can stop the agreement, but the city would take on the liability of 5% overage of the 725 costs. But to Ms. McCulloch's point, which I think is a good one, if the thing comes in crazy at $300,000, I think the district wants the opportunity, and it's not going to come in that cheap, but we can dream. But if it does come in that cheap, I think the district wants the opportunity to select and prioritize whatever they want, which is listed in the agreement, and the city would have no objection to that. I don't think it says that right now, but we'd have no objection to it. So okay. I think there's surety within the agreement to have that type of flexibility.
All right. So if the articulated concern is you just don't want to vote on it twice, Mrs. McCulloch, I guess I'm wondering if you would be more comfortable with the agreement if we period after that the city reserves the right to terminate the intergovernmental agreement. Because I'm sensing what you don't want to see is the rest of that sentence, or seek an amendment to the intergovernmental agreement that is mutually agreeable to both parties and approved by the respective governing bodies. You don't want us to be nickel and dimed. You don't want somebody coming back and saying, well, it's only $10,000 more, now we want you to pay that. I mean, would you be happy if there was just a period after intergovernmental agreement?
She's thinking. Okay.
So basically, it would come down to if it came back and the numbers were higher than the 5% contingency, then they have the opt out, but they can't come back to us for more. Is that what I hear you saying?
That's what I would say.
And would there be somewhere in there that indicated that we would be able to pick and choose if it came in under?
To add that language, it's a first reading, and my understanding would be that we can amend it between the first
Mr.
and the second
Ryan just said
reading.
That would be okay
right.
with him,
he did
but
say
I don't
that.
Know who else he has to go back and talk to. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so we have an amended motion on the floor with a second. So I guess I'll have the, you want to read that back to us? It's been a long time since we heard it.
Let me read it.
Just start with this.
Or Ms. McCulloch, do you want to restate
okay, the amended it? Motion I have, what is to remove? To secure a bid for the environmental demolition of the 201 South Madison Street location prior to being brought back to the board for a decision. And do we want to add this, Lord?
Secure a bid for the environmental remediation, demolition, and design services for the structure at 201 South Madison Street and use that bid in an IEGA to be brought back to the full Board of Education as an action item.
Okay. The coordinator call the roll on the amended motion.
Okay. Ms. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins? Mr. Scrivano?
No.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Herner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
No.
The motion passes with 4 yeses and 3 noes.
Now the underlying motion.
The amended motion. Mm-hmm. And now the.
So now we take a vote.
On the actual motion.
Now we
so you voted on the amendment first.
Right.
The amendment went
So we have a motion and a second, and we're going to call the roll. Can we hear that motion now?
You had to vote.
Ms. Holby.
You had to vote first on the amendment to the underlying motion. Now you're actually voting on the motion as amended.
The amendment was to not bring it to Ops Committee. So now we're voting on the motion that we're just bringing it back to the board.
Okay, I'll have the coordinator. I'll have the coordinator call the roll on the original motion. She stepped out.
Mrs. McCulloch.
I'm serious.
There is no discussion now. The roll is being called.
Okay, I need your vote.
Yes.
Dr. Herner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
No.
Mrs. Powers?
Let's go slow.
Yes.
Let's continue.
Excuse me. Ms. Jackson.
Yes.
Mr. Rollins.
No.
Mr. Scribano.
No.
The amended motion passes with 4 yeses and 3 noes.
All right, thank you. We are on to the Auburn Fieldhouse upgrades, Mr. Schmidt.
On the screen is you have this handout in your packet. What we're looking at, the board did approve the Fieldhouse addition for Auburn High School. At that time, it was for a base bid of standard fluorescent light LED or lighting and vinyl composite tile flooring. What we're doing is we're making a recommendation to move forward to upgrade the lighting as a change order to the original construction agreement of $13.1 million, a change order of $250,000 for LED lighting upgrade in the Fieldhouse area, increasing the front entry vestibule to terrazzo, and then the hallways and the classrooms and the cafeteria to use a new quartz tile that we're looking at. It's a little bit more resilient than the VCT tile. This is a change order to the existing agreement. We do have the construction bid was $13.1 million. We currently have $14.1 million sitting in there. We do have $1 million sitting there as a contingency fund for some of our constructions. We have used approximately $300,000 of that of the underground contingency for storm pipes, for undercutting some contaminant soil and things of that nature. So we do have funding available into contingency for this. So we're looking at, administration's looking for the board to approve this change order, about $250,000 for the lighting upgrade and the flooring upgrade at Auburn Fieldhouse. On this, we did, this was the first package that we sent out. With the Guilford one, we put these as alternates, and we were able to approve these as alternates and still stay under budget.
Comments or questions for Mr. Schmidt? Mrs. Powers.
Well, I'm not techie. I don't use board docs, and I don't have a copy of it, so if you could make sure that I get a copy of that. And then my other question was, not totally specific to this, but we were talking about it a little bit. All of the, as Tim, Mr. Rollins called them, the furniture fixtures, what have you. So the sound system, is that part of that other bucket, not structural?
I'm not sure I'm following.
Sound system in the field house?
Oh, yes.
And so the bid for that, or the quality and the budget and all of that, comes out of that fixtures and that other budget?
The funds we have, and we'll have to, because part of this, as we've built the additions, we put sound systems in the cafeterias and the field houses and the gyms. That's
okay.
One thing that
Thank
we're
you.
Doing.
I just yep. wanted to confirm. Okay. So
I was just going to make a comment that, you know, I watched the ops meeting, and I believe that this was strongly supported by the community members on the ops committee, because it made sense in long-term upkeep and savings, energy savings and all that. So I think it was very well supported by our community members on that committee. So, Mr. Rollins.
I just want to say that, too. It was a unanimous recommendation of the operations committee. The floor, other than one who may not have said anything, apparently. The flooring, is my understanding, it's a lower maintenance, so over time we'll save money on the flooring. The lighting, same thing, it's a lower energy cost. It will also, this field house will actually be air conditioned. One of the other advantages of LED lights is that they'll reduce your air conditioning costs because they don't throw off as much heat. The other thing that I did, and I pointed this out at the operations committee, we originally did not even ask for this as an alternate on the Auburn Fieldhouse, because the Auburn Fieldhouse was the first package that we went out for. The costs came in so low on Auburn compared with the estimates that we asked for this as an alternate on the Guilford Fieldhouse, and we as a board have already approved that, accepting those alternates on the Guilford Fieldhouse. And so, I mean, for the same reasons we accepted them in the Guilford Fieldhouse, I think we should be doing this for the Auburn Fieldhouse as well.
McCullough.
Well, you answered one of my questions, because we do have three field houses that we're building. And so Guilford would have the same upgrades. Where are we at? Would we be doing the same thing at East then, or would they go in? Are they in the bids that are out to do that right now, so that we don't have to do amended?
Yes, East is not out on the street. We're still finalizing that design, but we have that. What we're doing for any package moving forward is some of the lighting we have as a base is a LED, and then we have alternates for LED. One of the standards we want to go moving forward is to have parking lot, any lighting that we put in our buildings, LED lighting, and also upgrading with the alternate for the terrazzo. We're looking at the quartz tile as potentially being our standard moving forward. So.
And that was going to be my next question. I know the terrazzo, and lifelong, I mean, half of us went to schools that the terrazzo is still fine, I'm sure, more than half. But I'm not so sure what it is about the quartz tile that we're making that change. So if you could just share that. And I'm sure that's been taken care of by ops, but this is just an FYI.
And actually, we should make sure that you have the packing and ops, because we had some examples in there. We have a high school district in the Chicago suburbs that we went and visit that has the quartz tile in there along with the VCT. And you take the pictures. They've been there for 2 years, and you can definitely see the difference in there, where the VCT is already cracking, and they're looking at replacing some of those areas where the quartz looks like it's brand new. And it's also, with the maintenance, is a less amount of waxing that you have to put on there on a yearly basis, which is going to save us on our maintenance and our cost for custodials.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? This will come up for a vote at our next board meeting. Any other new business items or agenda recommendations? Ms. Powers.
So I'm wondering if we could consider as a board the idea of offering restitution for students who may pull fire drills or things like that. I know that with the percentage of our students that are on free and reduced lunch, if we could offer another alternative. So I'd ask the board to think about that.
The other thing is that I know that we just recently passed a board policy indicating that if we have any waiting lists for any special programs or buildings, that those waiting lists be published on our website. And I know that there was made reference to a waiting list for some of our alternative schools, our alternative learning environments. So I wanted to ensure that we've got those waiting lists out on our website. And then the last thing was, it's been almost a month since the start of the second quarter or the second semester, and I did ask for a start of school scorecard, and there's no date. I'm wondering when I'm gonna get that.
Okay, thank you. I just wanted to add one more item, and that is that just an announcement that the board has decided to hold a special board meeting on Saturday, February 22nd from 9 to 10:30 a.m. The purpose of that board meeting is for us to review our 7 board strategic priorities and their progress, and that will be an open meeting. And so I wanted everyone to know that anyone that wants to be there can be there. And it will be held in the boardroom at Swedish American Hospital Saturday, February 22nd at 9 a.m., which is on the fourth floor by the cafeteria. Any other items? Ms. Jackson.
Not necessarily an item, but a comment. There were several concerns raised about the youth court, so I'm hoping to have the information that was requested back before we vote on that, please.
Okay.
And?
Ms. McCullough.
Just to reiterate, I know we gave the schedule for the code of conduct meetings previously, but there is one on the 20th, which will be before our next board meeting at 4 p.m. at West Middle School. So not sure how communication is getting that out there, but the next one is February 20th. It's on Thursday at 4 p.m. at West. And I didn't look up if it's in the library or if it's up in another room. I apologize.
Ms. Powers.
The weekly update said that the Truth Talk debates would likely be at Auburn. Do we have a location for those?
Mr. Dutton?
It is Auburn.
That's on the 22nd, right? Okay.
Same time as our retreat. They start 9 to 11:30, right? We'll have to finish up because I need to get over there.
Okay.
And Mr. President, it's in room 103 in West.
West on the 20th. Okay. Any other business? If not,
motion to adjourn.
I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All right, thank you.